This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. In linguistics, language death also language extinction, linguistic extinction or linguicide, and rarely also glottophagy occurs when a language loses its last native speaker. Language death is a process that affects speech communities where the level of linguistic competence that speakers possess of a given language variety is decreased, eventually resulting in no native or fluent speakers of the variety. Language death may affect any language idiom, including dialects and languages. Language death should not be confused with language attrition, also called language loss, which describes the loss of proficiency in a language at the individual level. Contents 1 types 2 consequences on grammar 3 language revitalization 4 dead languages and normal language change 5 measuring language vitality 6 see also 7 references 8 further reading 9 external links. Types language death is typically the final outcome of language shift, and may manifest itself in one of the following ways: gradual language death, bottom to top language death, when language shift begins in a low-level environment such as the home, top to bottom language death, when language shift begins in a high-level environment such as the government, radical language death, linguicide also known as sudden death, language genocide, physical language death, biological language death. The most common process leading to language death is one in which a community of speakers of one language becomes bilingual with another language, and gradually shifts allegiance to the second language until they cease to use their original, heritage language. This is a process of assimilation which may be voluntary or may be forced upon a population. Speakers of some languages, particularly regional or minority languages, may decide to abandon them based on economic or utilitarian grounds, in favor of languages regarded as having greater utility or prestige. This process is gradual and can occur from either bottom to top or top to bottom. Languages with a small, geographically isolated population of speakers can also die when their speakers are wiped out by genocide, disease, or natural disaster. A language is often declared to be dead even before the last native speaker of the language has died if there are only a few elderly speakers of a language remaining, and they no longer use that language for communication, then the language is effectively dead. A language that has reached such a reduced stage of use is generally considered moribund once a language is no longer a native language, that is, if no children are being socialized into it as their primary language, the process of transmission is ended and the language itself will not survive past the current generation. This is rarely a sudden event, but a slow process of each generation learning less and less of the language, until its use is relegated to the domain of traditional use, such as in poetry and song. Typically the transmission of the language from adults to children becomes more and more restricted, to the final setting that adults speaking the language will raise children who never acquire fluency. One example of this process reaching its conclusion is that of the Dalmatian language. Language death can be fast, when the children are taught to avoid their parents' language for reasons such as work opportunities and social status at other times. Minority languages survive much longer, for example when the speakers try to isolate themselves against a majority population. Often, especially historically, governments have tried to promote language death. Not wishing to have minority languages' consequences on grammar during language loss, sometimes referred to as obsolescence in the linguistic literature, the language that is being lost generally undergoes changes as speakers make their language more similar to the language that they are shifting to. This process of change has been described by Apple 1983 in 2 categories, though they are not mutually exclusive. Often speakers replace elements of their own language with something from the language they are shifting toward also. If their heritage language has an element that the new language does not, speakers may drop it. Over generalization, under generalization, loss of phonological contrasts, variability, changes in word order, morphological loss, such as was seen in Scottish Gaelic in East Sutherland, Scotland. Dorian, 1978. As fluent speakers still used the historic plural formation, whereas semi-speakers used simple suffixation or did not include any plural formation at all, synthetic morphosyntax may become increasingly analytic. Syntactic loss, i.e. lexical categories, complex constructions, relexification, loss of word formation, productivity, style loss, such as the loss of ritual speech, morphological leveling, analogical leveling. Language revitalization. Main article, language revitalization. Language revitalization is an attempt to slow or reverse language death. Revitalization programs are ongoing in many languages, and have had varying degrees of success. The revival of the Hebrew language in Israel is the only example of a language languages acquiring new first language speakers after it became extinct in everyday use for an extended period, being used only as a liturgical language even in the case of Hebrew. There is a theory that argues that the Hebrew revivalists who wished to speak pure Hebrew failed. The result is a fascinating and multifaceted Israeli language, which is not only multi-layered but also multi-sourced. The revival of a clinically dead language is unlikely without cross-fertilization from the revivalists' mother tongues. Other cases of language revitalization which have seen some degree of success are Irish, Welsh, Hawaiian, Cherokee, and to a lesser extent Navajo as a response to English linguistic dominance. De-Anglicization became a matter of national pride in some places and especially in regions that were once under colonial rule, where vestiges of colonial domination are a sensitive subject following centuries of English rule in Ireland and English imposition of the English language. An argument for de-Anglicization was delivered before the Irish National Literary Society in Dublin, the 25th of November 1892, when we speak of the necessity for de-Anglicizing the Irish nation, we mean it, not as a protest against imitating what is best in the English people, for that would be absurd, but rather to show the folly of neglecting what is Irish, and hastening to adopt, pell-mell, and indiscriminately, everything that is English, simply because it is English. Language was one of the features of Anglicization in Ireland, although it never died out and became an official language after independence. Irish had lost its status as the island's principal vernacular to become a minority language during the period of English rule. Similarly, in North America, indigenous languages have been replaced by those of the colonists. According to Gilad Zuckerman, language reclamation will become increasingly relevant as people seek to recover their cultural autonomy, empower their spiritual and intellectual sovereignty, and improve well-being. There are various ethical, aesthetic, and utilitarian benefits of language revival, for example, historical justice, diversity, and employability, respectively. Dead languages and normal language change. This section needs additional citations for verification. Please help improve this article by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. December 2015. Learn how and when to remove this template message. Linguists distinguish between language death and the process where a language becomes a dead language through normal language change, a linguistic phenomenon analogous to pseudo-extinction. This happens when a language in the course of its normal development gradually morphs into something that is then recognized as a separate, different language, leaving the old form with no native speakers. Thus, for example, Old English may be regarded as a dead language, although it changed and developed into Middle English, Early Modern English, and Modern English. The process of language change may also involve the splitting up of a language into a family of several daughter languages, leaving the common parent language dead. This has happened to Latin, which through Vulgar Latin eventually developed into the Romance languages, and to Prakrit, which developed into the new Indo-Aryan languages. Such a process is normally not described as language death, because it involves an unbroken chain of normal transmission of the language from one generation to the next, with only minute changes at every single point in the chain. Thus, with regard to Latin, for example, there is no point at which Latin died. It evolved in different ways in different geographic areas, and its modern forms are now identified by a plethora of different names such as French, Portuguese, Spanish, Italian, Romanian, Catalan, Galician, Venetian, etc. Measuring language vitality. Except in case of linguicide, languages do not suddenly become extinct, they become moribund as the community of speakers gradually shifts to using other languages. As speakers shift, there are discernible, if subtle, changes in language behavior. These changes in behavior lead to a change of linguistic vitality in the community. There are a variety of systems that have been proposed for measuring the vitality of a language in a community. One of the earliest is GIDS, Graded Intergenerational Disruption Scale, proposed by Joshua Fishman in 1991, a noteworthy publishing milestone in measuring language vitality. Is an entire issue of Journal of Multilingual and Multicultural Development devoted to the study of ethnolinguistic vitality, volume 322, 2011, with several authors presenting their own tools for measuring language vitality. A number of other published works on measuring language vitality have been published, prepared by authors with varying situations and applications in mind. These include works by Ariane Dwyer, Martin Ahala, M. Lynn Landwehr, Mark Caron, Andras Kornai, and Paul Lewis and Gary Simon. See also Classical Language, Cultural Genocide, Cultural Hegemony, Endangered Language, Lists of Endangered Languages, Ethnocide, Extinct Language, Lists of Extinct Languages, International Auxiliary Language, Language Contact, Language Policy, Language Revitalization, Language Shift, List of Last Known Speakers of Languages, Linguistic Discrimination. Linguistic imperialism, linguistic purism, linguistic rights, the linguists, documentary film, minority language, prestige language, regional language, Rosetta Project, language movement, anti-Hindi agitations of Tamil Nadu, references, Carrot, A. B. Zuckerman, Gillot, Stop, Revive and Survive, The Australian Higher Education, June 6, 2012, Carrot, Calvet, Jean-Louis, 1974, Long et Colonialisme, Petit Traité de Glottophagie, Paris, Carrot, A. B. Crystal, David, 2000, Language Death, Cambridge, UK, Cambridge University Press, Carrot, Knowles Berry, Susan Winter, 1987, Linguistic Decay in Chontal Mayan, The Speech of Semi-Speakers, Anthropological Linguistics, 29:4-332-341, JSTOR. Journal equals at position 7 help, line feed character in, title equals at position 52 help, Carrot, Ahala, Martin, 2009, An Evaluation Matrix for Ethnolinguistic Vitality in Susanna Pertot, Tom Priestley. Glossa, an Interdisciplinary Journal, Volume 2, Num 2, Batibo, Herman M. 2005, Language Decline and Death in Africa, Causes, Consequences, and Challenges, Multilingual Matters, Brenzinger, Matthias ed. 1992, Language Death, Factual and Theoretical Explorations with Special Reference to East Africa, Berlin, New York, Mouton de Gruyter, Brenzinger, Mathé ed. 1998, Endangered Languages in Africa, Cologne, Rudiger Koper, Verlag Broderick, George, 1999, Language Death in the Isle of Man, Tübingen, Niemeyer, ISBN 3-484-30395-6, Calvet, Louis Jean, 1998, Language Wars and Linguistic Politics, Oxford, Oxford University Press, Campbell, Lyle, 1994, Language Death in R. E. Asher ed., The Encyclopedia of Language and Linguistics, pp. 0-521-65321-5, Crystal, David, 2004, Language Revolution, Cambridge, Polity Press, Sear, Christine, 2008, How Do You Learn a Dead Language, Slate, Dalby, Andrew, 2003, Language in Danger, The Loss of Linguistic Diversity and the Threat to Our Future, New York, Columbia University Press, ISBN 0-231-12900-9, Dixon, RMW, 1997, The Rise and Fall of Languages, Cambridge, Cambridge University Press, Dorian, Nancy C. 1973, Grammatical Change in a Dying Dialect Language, 49, 413-438, Dorian, Nancy C. 1978, Fate of Morphological Complexity in Language Death, Evidence from East Sutherland Gaelic Language, 54, 3, 590-609, Dorian, Nancy C. 1981, Language Death, The Life Cycle of a Scottish Gaelic Dialect, Philadelphia, University of Pennsylvania Press, Dorian, Nancy C. ed. 1989, Investigating Obsolescence, Studies in Language Contraction and Death, Studies in the Social and Cultural Foundations of Language, No. 7, Cambridge, Cambridge University Press, ISBN 0-521-32405-X, Dressler, Wolfgang. Grenoble, Lenore A. Competition, and Language Coexistence, Columbus, Ohio State University, Mafi, Lucia ed. 2001, On Biocultural Diversity, Linking Language, Knowledge, and the Environment, Washington, D.C., Smithsonian Institution Press, Moray, Jacques. Robbins, R.H. Lost Tongues and the Politics of Language Endangerment, Languages Don't Kill Languages, Speakers Do Language Endangerment, What Have Pride?